Welcome back. Isn't it amazing again how much they can cover in such a short video, giving us so much of the content of this book, giving us all of those images that help us to remember the biblical stories and also help us to consider the structure of this book of Judges. But there are some things we need to address about how the biblical book of Judges and the judges themselves are presented in this book, because I feel that some of it is mischaracterized. I guess first and foremost, I want to point out this, that it seems to be that the creators of the Bible Project are overly ashamed of any sort of violence in the Bible. When they see anything that seems rather brutal, they seem to try to want to hide it, or they want to pin it on someone other than God, as if that is not worthy of God. Now, again, there is a lot of violence that simply is the result of evil people doing evil things in the Bible, but there is also a lot of activity in the Bible, which is actually things that God says he is doing that appears to us as violent or brutal. But what we see is that's really just God pouring out his wrath as he should upon sin. Now, thanks be to God, he does not do this all the time, and ultimately, right, saved his wrath to be poured out on Christ. But he does at particular points in history when people have rejected him for a long time and have not lived in his ways and stubbornly refused to repent, he does pour out his wrath also in time now. And so we see this throughout the Old Testament, and we need not be ashamed of that, because that is actually our God acting against his enemies justly. And so there's no shame in that. In fact, those acts are good because God is good and he is doing them. When we see them, it should terrify us a little bit, because we too at times are those who are stubborn about our sins. And so when we see God pour out his wrath upon sin, it should drive us to repentance. And then once we've repented, thanks be to God, God forgives us for the sake of Christ. He gives us his mercy and grace, and he sets us free from those sins. But we need not just jump every time there's violence and go, oh no, what's going on here? Let's hide this. Let's not talk about it, or let's try to pin it on somebody else. So I hope that's clear as to what I'm talking about. If not, leave some comments in the video, and the video comments, and I'll try to explain it more in advance. So what do they get wrong, quote unquote, or what do they mischaracterize in this video? Well, overall, like I said, they seem to think that the overall point of this book is just that this is sort of the worst period ever in the history of Israel. I'm not sure that's right. As we go forward into the book of Kings, we'll certainly see a lot more evil there as well. What is this? Well, as they do rightly point out, it is all about this cycle that is in the book that shows how often God saves us, we fail to live up to the life that he has given us. We sin, yes, and then we get in trouble, and then God again hears our cries for mercy and he saves us. We'll come back to that in a little bit. But to me, that's much more the point of the book rather than just this is the worst time ever in the history of Israel. How do I see this particularly in this video that they mischaracterize it? Well, really, when you get into the three judges that are highlighted in the little longer sections of this book, I think we see this. First, we meet Gideon, who we're told is sort of the best of the three, and yet the first thing they say about him is he is a coward. And there's no doubt that Gideon had doubts about whether he could lead the people of God against this vast army of the Midianites. I don't know if I would characterize that as being cowardly, but rather as having doubts or lacking the proper faith to go about and do that. But God does not chastise him very harshly for asking for some signs, and so I think we want to be careful to not do so either. The other thing that we're told about Gideon is that after we have this wonderful story of Gideon defeating the Midianites, his 300 men versus that vast army, we're told that everything goes downhill from there, and we're told that Gideon has a nasty temper and he goes and kills some fellow Israelites. Now, it is true that Gideon and his men do inflict punishment on some fellow Israelites. But why? Well, if you read the story, it's because when they're passing through that area, trying to go and catch up to the last two kings of the Midianites, we find out that he asks these fellow Israelites to feed his soldiers so they can complete the task because they're exhausted, and they refuse to do so. They refuse to do so because they want to be assured that the whole victory is going to be won before they side with their fellow brothers, the Israelites. So again, this is a wicked activity. This perhaps would be best described as cowardly. So these Israelites are not just slaughtered. You know, Gideon gets a rage about him and decides to go out and slaughter a bunch of his fellow Israelites. Again, the Bible presents this as a just judgment of God upon these Israelites because they do not join with their brothers to finish the battle against the Midianites. We're also told that Gideon makes an idol right up front. Well, what he actually makes is an ephod, which is sort of a garment that priests would wear. He makes it out of silver. And indeed, we are told that he sort of places it in a city for people to see, sort of a, we might say, a monument to this great victory that God has produced. And like they said, it is true that the people end up treating it as an idol. But I think it's way overkill to say that Gideon creates an idol. No, he creates this ephod, and then people turn it into an idol, as people often do. They take something that is good or harmless and turn it into an idol. And that's what happens here as well. When we get into the story of Japheth, we're told that he's a mafia thug. Well, he indeed is a rough character, and we are told he's out, you know, up in the hill country, kind of running around with a band of bad brothers. But we do leave out there in that story that part of why he's out there is that he's been thrown out of his family because the rest of his family doesn't like him because he is the result of a union between his father and a harlot. And so he gets kicked out originally, so maybe we at least have a little bit of sympathy for why he's even out there. That's not to deny that he seems to be a pretty rowdy and perhaps ruthless individual. But again, it seems a little bit of an overkill to me. Then the other thing it says at the end is it kind of makes this quick statement that he becomes like the Canaanites and he's willing to sacrifice his daughter. Well, he is in this sense willing to sacrifice his daughter at the end of the story simply because he makes a vow. But if you look at that vow, as we'll do later, we'll see that in fact, when he makes that vow, he is certainly not saying, if you give me the victory, I will sacrifice my daughter, which is what I thought the video made it out to do. Instead, no, he says that whatever kind of comes out of his house after the victory, he will offer up. Now, again, biblical scholars disagree on whether he would have been anticipating that some sort of animal would have been coming out of his household, or even if he had got to the point where he thought he should give a human sacrifice, which would have been indeed a terrible thing to say. But we don't know really what he was anticipating, but it would be way overkill to say that he was anticipating that it would be his daughter that he would sacrifice. He does, though, take this vow he made to the Lord seriously when it happens, and he is, though, troubled by the fact that it is his daughter. So again, in trying to cover that quickly, I think they kind of overemphasize sort of an evil intention there behind Japheth that is not there. Then with Samson, we're told right at the beginning that he is promiscuous, and that I think is a fair characterization. We find him marrying a Philistine woman, which he's not supposed to do. We see him going to a harlot. Then there's all the stuff with Samson and Delilah. So he certainly, at the very least, seems to have a weakness for women. But then we're also told that he's very violent. Well, the problem here again is if you look at the places where Samson is quote unquote violent, it is actually when the Spirit of the Lord comes upon him and he destroys the Philistines. And so here again, this is part of what God is doing in punishing the Philistines and also fulfilling his promise to deliver this land to the Israelites. And so that violence there is not just Samson being a mean, nasty guy, but instead is something that God does as part of what he is doing in this particular part of history. The other thing, again, I could get into more specifics. The other thing is they say that Samson, you know, finished off his life as a mass murderer. You know, it almost seems like they act like in our modern context that he went into a shopping mall with an AK-47 or something. But what he actually did, again, was he asked God for the power to be able to destroy the Philistines. After he's had his eyes poked out and he's been weakened, he asks for strength one more time and God gives it to him and he pushes out these pillars. Maybe you remember this story. He pushes out these pillars and the Philistines, great and small, are killed and Samson dies with them. And I think really the Bible presents this as a real story of self-sacrifice much more than an act of mass murder in the sense of, you know, just some evil intention just to kill people for the sake of killing it. So again, I think that's quite a mischaracterization there of Samson. Why do I care overall? Well, because each of these judges are God's people that he sends. And therefore, since he sends these people to save his people, they also each time give us a little picture of Jesus. For instance, with Samson, if we say that he is there sacrificing his own life, right? The only way he can destroy the Philistines is also to die himself as these pillars are pushed out. Well, that gives us kind of a wonderful foretaste of what Jesus is going to do, that he's going to give up his own life in order that God's people might be saved. And so again, I think we want to be very careful to turn the judges here just into evil people doing evil things, whom God sort of every once in a while almost magically grabs and does good things with. Are the judges perfect? By no means. Do they do things that aren't right? Of course they do, but God does still use them to carry out good things, to carry out his justice, to save his people. This is what he does with the judges, and we are thankful for the things he does rather than just throwing them all under the bus. I know that's a bit of a long explanation, but I think it was important after watching this video to talk about this, lest we sort of be confused about the overall nature of the judges in the Bible. Let's then go ahead and look at some of the basics of this book. First, we'll look at the who, which is usually where we talk about who wrote this book. Again, with the book of Judges, we're not told who wrote the book. Some people think it was perhaps the prophet Samuel, but we really don't know. Then we go to the what. Well, this is about 300 years of history of the Israelites, the period between Joshua's reign and the reign of the kings. And so that's this whole 300-year period. I think if we're reading through this book or thinking through it, we often think it's a much shorter period. But remember, 300 years of history where this cycle that we'll talk about again later is going on. When? Well, it is generally thought to cover from about 1380 BC to 1050 BC, and most scholars believe that it was probably written down somewhere between 1050 and 1000 BC. Where is this happening? Well, in the Promised Land, and particularly the central highlands where the people of God first go into the Promised Land. Why is this included in the scriptures? Well, because of this cycle of sin. We too know this cycle well, that we sin, that then we receive the results of our sin. We cry out to God. Thanks be to God, he has mercy on us in Jesus. And then he gives us rest, both in the sense of forgiveness and ultimately in bringing us into a new land, a new heaven and a new earth where we will have eternal rest with him. And so we can very much relate to this cycle that is going on in the book of Judges, where humanity sins, and then God saves them. Let's look at a couple of the key verses. The first one would be Judges 1:1, the first book. It says, "After the death of Joshua, the people of Israel inquired of the Lord, 'Who shall go up first for us against the Canaanites to fight against them?'" So just like there was a turnover from Moses to Joshua, now the question is, well, who's going to lead us now? Especially when there's a battle to be fought, people then want to have a mighty leader over them. And so we see this kind of sets the stage. Who is it going to be? And the answer ultimately is it's going to be these judges that are put forth. They're the ones that God is going to fight against the Canaanites and fulfill his promises about bringing his people to rest in this promised land. Now let's get from Judges 2, 16 through 19, and this is this important cycle that is throughout this entire book. It says, "Then the Lord raised up judges who saved them out of the hand of those who plundered them. Yet they did not listen to their judges, for they whored after other gods and bowed down to them. They soon turned aside from the way in which their fathers had walked, who had obeyed the commandments of the Lord, and they did not do so. Whenever the Lord raised up judges for them, the Lord was with the judge, and he saved them from the hand of their enemies all the days of the judge. For the Lord was moved to pity by their groaning because of those who afflicted and oppressed them. But whenever the judge died, they turned back and were more corrupt than their fathers, going after other gods, serving them and bowing down to them. They did not drop any of their practices or their stubborn ways." What a sad story, but again, it is the story that we see throughout the scriptures, and sadly, we even see in our own lives, right? We see that God brings us to a place of peace through his forgiveness. And then as we live in that peace, unfortunately, we tend to forget about him, and we tend to go to sin. And then, in one way or another, God allows the results of our sins to come upon us. In this book, nations come and oppress the Israelites time and time again. When this happens, the people finally sort of wake up to their sad reality, and they cry out to God that he might save them. And blessedly, time and time again, he does save them. He brings them peace and rest. And then that cycle, unfortunately, starts over. Like I said, we see this in the Bible throughout many stories, particularly here in the book of Judges, but not solely here by any means. We see it in our own lives, this cycle of us sinning, us getting in trouble with the results of our sins. We recognize it, we cry out to God, and he forgives us and gives us peace and rest again as he delivers us through Jesus for us, right? So we see this cycle there. This cycle is sort of shown every time we come into the Lord's house, when we go through the liturgy that the Christian church has used, right? We kind of can imagine that each Sunday we go out in peace, and then during the week, right, we get wrapped up in sin and the results of sin. We come into the Lord's house and we confess again our sins, and then God forgives us and gives us peace and rest again. We can get into a lot more specifics there, but think about that every time you come into the house of the Lord, that you are bringing the sins and the effects of those sins of the past week, and you're bringing those to the Lord in repentance. And blessedly, he saves you week after week, and he brings you back to peace and rest. Okay, let's look at a few more verses. Judges 5:31. It says, "And so may all your enemies perish, O Lord, but your friends be like the sun as he rises in his might." And the land had rest for 40 years. This is right after the story of the biblical judge Deborah and Barak, and we get these other characters, Jael and Sisera, that get involved in this story. You can go back and read that sometime. But here, I thought it was just important to put in here again that what is going on at this time, again, is that God is taking his friends and he's exalting them. His friends are Israel largely, right? As he has chosen them. That's why they're his friends, not because they're perfect people. But he exalts them. And then he also, though, does make all of his enemies perish. And we see this right in the book. And that, you know, going back to my original comments, we see here that when God punishes his enemies, it is a good action. It is a just action. And we need not be ashamed of it, but let it drive us to repentance of our own sins, lest we would also perish. Instead, right, let us find life again in Christ and eternal life at that. Judges 7:20 takes us into the story of Gideon. It says, "Then the three companies blew the trumpets and broke the jars. They held in their left hands the torches and their right hands the trumpets to blow. And they cried out, 'A sword for the Lord and a sword for Gideon.'" If you haven't read the story of Gideon lately, go back and read it. It's this great story where God narrows down Gideon's army to 300 men, and they fight this army of the Midianites, which is pictured as a vast army. Looks like locusts in the valley, almost not able to number the amount of people there in the Midianites army. And God gives them victory, even though what they take with them to battle are these clay pots, these lanterns, and also trumpets. They make noise, they let light come out as they're surrounding the enemy, and the enemy essentially turns on themselves, and then Gideon and his men get to go up and sort of just clean up, and that's how God gives them victory. But there's a right, and they shout, "A sword for the Lord and a sword for Gideon." Let's go to a story from Japheth just to get the key kind of event in this. So it says in Judges 11:30, "And Japheth made a vow to the Lord and said, 'If you will give the Ammonites into my hand, then whatever comes out from the doors of my house to meet me when I return in peace from the Ammonites shall be the Lord's, and I will offer it up for a burnt offering.'" Notice how the translators here use the word "whatever" and "it," and that is a good translation, and it really points to this fact that we're not talking about Japheth in advance saying, "I will offer up a child sacrifice if you, O Lord, give me victory." No, he is simply offering the Lord something he is going to do once he sees the Lord give him victory. And so again, the whole idea is not bad, and even to, you know, make this vow to sort of give a praise or thank offering to God in this sense. A burnt offering here, but he makes that promise, and he says there, right, he's going to do this. It turns out tragically, no doubt, but Japheth here is simply, again, asking God to fulfill his promise, and then he wants to make a burnt offering to recognize God's bringing victory for his people. The last one we'll read is a little bit from the story of Samson. This is from Judges 16. It says, "Then Samson called to the Lord and said, 'O Lord God, please remember me and strengthen me only this once, O God, that I may be avenged on the Philistine for my two eyes.' And Samson grasped the two middle pillars on which the house rested, and he leaned his weight against them, his right hand on one and his left hand on the other. And Samson said, 'Let me die with the Philistines.' Then he bowed with all his strength, and the house fell upon the lords and upon the people who were in it. So the dead whom he killed at his death were more than those whom he had killed during his life." Now, again, I think that last phrase would almost be embarrassing to the Bible Project people. You know, why are we, you know, going on and on about how many people he killed? Well, because this is the judgment of God upon the Philistines. And that is what we are rejoicing in here. And that's why Samson is almost eulogized as saying this was his greatest act he ever did. I said the last verse, I forgot one. This one is important. It was on their list as well of important verses that they placed into the imagery. Judges 21:25 says, "In those days, there was no king in Israel. Everyone did what was right in his own eyes." Again, this is a statement we can identify with, right? We often do it when we look out from ourselves and we say, look, everyone's doing what's right in their own eyes. There's a bunch of sin going on, right? And we like to kind of at first point the finger outward. But if the mirror comes up in front of us, all of a sudden we go, ugh, this is us too, right? We don't treat God as if he is our king. And therefore, we also end up doing whatever we think is right. And again, when that happens, we should be terrified at the thought of God's wrath upon sin. And that should drive us to repentance. And that will bring us back to where God then graciously forgives us our sins for the sake of Christ who died and rose for us. Look into this book if you've not read it recently. You will not get bored reading the book of Judges. All of these stories are quite enthralling in what happened and the details of the story. And overall, it shows us again our saving God. We could say again, the overall theme of this book is simply God's people sin, then God's people suffer, and then God saves them. He gives them rest. That's the biblical book of Judges, and I hope this brief overview has been helpful to you again this day.